Okay, well, let's get started. We're actually a minute or two late here already. So the first speaker at the session will be Richard Allen and a cast of several hundred other co-authors here, talking about CISN Shake Alert delivering test warnings for California earthquakes. No, that would have given you time.
Thanks, John. So as John mentioned, there's a large author list here, 20 co-authors. This is, I'm going to give an overview of a project that's been underway for in our sixth year now. It's a collaborative project amongst several institutions to start to develop early warning methodologies and test them for California. And I really want to acknowledge this long authorship. These are folks who are all very much engaged with the project, and it's their continual collaboration that has made this possible. And in particular, I just want to acknowledge my co-PIs on this project, Tom Heaton, who's here, George Akua, and Phil Mackling. Okay, so there'll be more about this afternoon. There's a total of 9 posters by this group talking about the various aspects of this Shake Alert project, so I encourage you to go and see those. I'm going to start by talking about the status of Shake Alert today. So the status today, this is what my desktop computer looks like. As usual, I'm reading email, unfoortunately. And from time to time, a desktop app pops up to tell me that there's an earthquake underway. This is what we call the user display. You probably recognize this particular earthquake. This is obviously a scenario. This is the Loma Prieta earthquake. And it's showing you the countdown until we expect significant shaking right here. It's telling you what the countdown is. It's telling you the level of shaking to expect, moderate shaking in this particular case, as the S wave arrives right here in San Francisco where we are right now. So this is the user display. This is one of the ways that you can receive the alerts from the current test alert system. About 45 people are currently making use of this user display to get these alerts. So right now, and you can learn more about this. Maren Bowes was the the lead on putting together the user display, and you can see more on that on her poster this afternoon. So how is the system performing? So right now we sort of decided to put in a filter on the alerts that go out. The decision module issues the alerts. I'll talk more about that in a couple of moments. And we have filters. We only issue alerts when the expected magnitude is greater than 2.5 and the event likelihood is greater than 0.4. So based on that and based on the fact the system has been operating for the last 6 months, how has it performed? So this shows the errors in the source parameters. A magnitude error, a median error minus 0.2 units and a standard deviation of 0.3, median location error 4 kilometers, a median origin time error 0 seconds. And frankly, I think that that portion of the system is performing pretty well. The piece that needs improvement is when we look at the number of false and missed events. So when we look at real and false alerts over this last six-month period, 75% of the alerts that were issued were real events. 25% did not match an event in the ANSS catalog and therefore are false events. When we look at all of the magnitude greater than 3 earthquakes in California during this period, 65% of them were detected, and then 73% for greater than magnitude 3.5, and it's also 73% for greater than magnitude 4. And part of the reason for this, of course, is because the network in California is very heterogeneous. So our percentage of detection obviously increases in the regions where the networks are denser. We're now in the process of starting to be ready to deliver this alert feed to a group of external users. The advantages here, or the goals rather, are that for the users, they can start to think about how they might use earthquake early warning. For us, we're hoping for feedback on how to improve the system. We're looking for early adopters in a range of different areas: transportation, personal safety, process safety. Right now, we have 7 confirmed groups that are going to start to receive these alerts probably within the next few weeks, including Google, Deutsche Telekom, LA County Fire, UC Berkeley is doing this as a cross-campus, the Red Cross, BART, Caltrans, CalEMA. And there are other partners that we're currently talking to that we expect to add to this list. If you're interested, let us know more about this in Peggy Helwig's poster this afternoon. So the system architecture today, what does that look like? I'm going to start at the end user end. You've already seen the user display. That's obviously at the end of the entire system architecture. The alert feed that goes into that user display comes from this decision module that I mentioned a few moments ago. The decision module is essentially an aggregator. It takes inputs from a series of sources and combines them in order to come out with a unified alert stream that can then go out. It goes out using an XML message, a secure XML message over the internet. In addition to the user display, the community seismic network, Tom Heaton is leading an effort to use this alert in order to trigger the collection of waveform data on cell phones and other devices. But of course, this point is that this XML message can go into any automated control system, and that's what some of these user partners that we're working with are interested in doing. What feeds into the decision module? Well, it's the three algorithms that you may be familiar with, ELAMS, virtual seismologist, and on-site, all running independently, statewide, and feeding into the decision module to get this unified output. Another important piece to this component is the CISN testing center, operated by SCEC, USC, and they take out the same alert feed from the user coming out from the decision module, but they also get feeds from the algorithm alerts, and so they're able to then do a much more detailed performance assessment. Now, this architecture has been set up specifically to provide flexibility. Right now, it has inputs from these three algorithms, but the purpose of having this decision module is that we can add in additional algorithms, finite fault detection, GPS detection, methodologies that are currently underway, I'll mention in a minute, and for that matter, any future algorithm could feed into this decision module in the future. So, what does this decision module look like? What's it doing? So, it currently takes the feeds from the three algorithms. When more than one algorithm sees an event, it combines the information, essentially averages the magnitudes and the locations as appropriate, and then spits out the message using this message broker kind of approach. It's been operating for 6 months, as I mentioned. Typically, it processes 28,000 messages per month. And we also now have a heartbeat sort of monitoring effort so we can sort of maintain or monitor how that all of the system components are running at any particular time. It's encrypted, and as I mentioned, we have 45 users right now. Very quickly, the three algorithms that are feeding into it. The on-site algorithm is a single station-based approach. It uses PD and Tau-C, so it's looking at both the amplitude and the frequency content of the P-wave arrival with the intention of being able to provide a warning based on a single station detection. There is a two-station extension in place where they now also look for a second station to trigger close by to the first station before issuing that alert. Its reports are available about 5 seconds after the origin time, and then the uncertainties are about half a magnitude unit, plus or minus 15 kilometers. Second algorithm is the virtual seismologist. This is a network-based approach. This is being developed, the real-time component is developed out at ETH, and the current operational system requires a minimum of 4 stations for the first estimate, for the first magnitude estimate, for the first alert to go to the decision module, which is typically available about 20 seconds after the origin time. They detected many events, real events in California, 142 with magnitude greater than 3 in Southern California, 56 with magnitude greater than 3 in Northern California, and 98% of the correct detections are within one magnitude unit. And this algorithm, virtual seismologist, is also now going to expand out and be used as part of the REACT project that we'll hear about later across Europe. Finally, the third algorithm is the ELAMS algorithm. It's also a regional network-based approach. There are 2 versions of this algorithm right now. ELAMS version 1 is the version that currently feeds into the current decision module. It operates only on the northern coastal region, essentially this region here, so obviously including the Bay Area, the coastal region. And the reason for that is that we find that it doesn't perform so well in Southern California. We find that we detect 75% of magnitude greater than 3 earthquakes, and there's a false alarm rate of about 20% right now. ELAMS 2 is now actually running. It's operational, but it doesn't feed into the decision module. It's a completely rewritten version of ELAMS. The goal, of course, is to extend this to full statewide operation and also to increase the speed. And right now, we find that for Bay Area events, we're able to provide alerts 10 seconds after the origin time. Okay, so that's the current architecture and the current three algorithms. A quick overview of ongoing development. Starting with a development for the virtual seismologist, they're working on including not yet arrived data. So the fact that there have not been triggers at some stations when you've seen a trigger at an adjacent station, using that in order to come up with more accurate locations. The challenge there is being able to do that effectively when you have very variable latencies in your data. They're also working on using site amplification effects to improve the magnitude estimates, taking three approaches: an empirical station-based envelope correction, using VS30-based corrections, so the equivalent of the geologic map, and then also using what they call drift vectors based on previous observations of magnitude estimates. Finder is the finite fault detector that Maren Bose and the group at Caltech are working on. And the idea here is to, first of all, use a very rapid near versus far source classification when you have a trigger at a station to identify that we think a station is in the near field, and then compare that to a set of pre-calculated templates in order to try and detect the finiteness of a fault as the earthquake is propagating. Finally, at Berkeley, we've been working on using real-time GPS for large magnitude earthquakes. This shows an example waveform of from an accelerometer in blue and real-time GPS displacement provided by Yehuda Box Group. And what you can see immediately or very rapidly is the permanent static offset. And so we've developed a very simple algorithm to extract that that offset and then use that to determine magnitude. It turns out it's very robust from the very first estimate that you have from GPS. It's not quite as fast. The first GPS estimate is available at about the same time as peak shaking, but you can then use it to improve your estimate at stations further away. Okay, so as we are looking forward, where is it that we're going with this project? Well, we're very excited right now. It's actually been a pretty big couple of weeks for us in earthquake early warning on the West Coast, in that we are now planning on building a prototype early warning system that will extend to the entire West Coast of the U.S. And so this is obviously building on the ANSS infrastructure in the sense of the geophysical networks that the ANSS runs, and building on the CISN test system that I've just been summarizing for you. We can do this thanks to the generous support of the Moore Foundation that have provided a substantial grant in order to move this forward, and of course with the continued support of the USGS and with our collaboration with these public and private partners that I mentioned a few minutes ago. So what is it that we're going to do? This is a collaboration between Caltech, UC Berkeley, University of Washington, and the USGS. So we're going to extend the testing region to the entire West Coast. So rather than just California, it will also include Oregon and Washington. We're going to be studying large earthquake rupture and developing warning algorithms for that. We saw in the session earlier this morning some of the challenges for the really large magnitude events. We'll be integrating real-time GPS. We'll be extending the alerts to the rafters. What we mean by that is not just estimating the shaking at the free surface, but also talking about what we expect that shaking to do in buildings. And of course, delivering these test alerts to a group of public-private partners for evaluation. And so what we really see this as is a blueprint for a full public West Coast system at some point in the future. So by way of a summary, the path to public alerts for California. Where are we today? Well, we have user display currently in use by 45 scientists, so we have the beginnings of a test system already in place. Over the next few months, we expect to start delivering these alerts to these corporate and public partners. They're going to start receiving the alerts. They can start to develop what are the appropriate uses, and then, of course, be providing feedback to us about how we need to improve the system. Over the next 3 years, our plan is to build a prototype warning system for the West Coast. This is using mostly existing seismic and geodetic infrastructure, and so the energy will be in developing robust algorithms and also robust processing for all types of earthquakes that we expect on the West Coast. And then we'll be demonstrating its utility, hopefully, with these public-private sectors. But what this does not include, there's no 24/7 operation here, there's no hardening of network infrastructure. This is not something that can then become a public earthquake early warning system. So then in 2015, at the conclusion of this effort, that's when we hope to be able to make the case to build a public early warning system for the West Coast. The estimated cost is about $150 million. It's not really that expensive, frankly. This would provide earthquake early warning to everybody. And of course, the added bonus is that we would get the next generation of geophysical networks, which we can use for research purposes in much the same way we've been using the current network to develop earthquake early warning. This would provide the next generation geophysical networks for the next level of our understanding of earthquake physics and also earthquake mitigation strategies. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, maybe just one or two quick questions if someone has them. We can't see anything, so you have to wave vigorously. Okay, well, you're off the hook. Thank you. All right, well, where are we here? So the next talk will be by Ken Hudnut, real-time GPS integration for prototype earthquake early warning and near-field imaging of the earthquake rupture process. Okay, so this will turn yellow, I think, 2 minutes beforehand, then red after 12 minutes.
Okay. I'm looking for version 5 of the talk.
Thank you. Great. So I'd like to just start out by acknowledging the help of my co-authors from USGS Earthquake Program and Volcano Program here. We've been meeting for several years periodically to discuss progress of the different groups as we've been testing various options for real-time GPS processing. So let's see here. Is there a mouse that I can click? Right.
Yeah.
Oh, perfect. Thanks. Okay. So the USGS Natural Hazards Mission Area has responsibility within the U.S. federal government for issuing alerts for earthquakes, volcanic eruptive activity, and landslides. Of course, we support NSS, and through seismic networks, we also support NOAA's tsunami warnings. And so really the same goes for our development with the real-time GPS technology. We are working towards integrating real-time GPS into our existing systems for issuing alerts, working with many partners on that. And so in terms of our USGS internal testing, we've been working especially with the Volcano Program and Mike Lisowski in particular, but also Mike Poland and Asta Miklios at HVO. Real-time GPS is seen as an important new technology for improving timely characterization and aiding in modeling of events as they're happening, and there's been overwhelming support here at this AGU meeting. Thorne Lay's talk and Hiro Kanemori's talk have been especially impressive to me, and we certainly would like to be able to respond positively by helping to offer robust, reliable real-time GPS results in real time. We're still working on that, so we have been testing a variety of options over several years. We do appreciate that finite fault source modeling for very large earthquakes would be greatly aided by having robust, reliable GPS in real time. So, and this would be, of course, helpful for early warning, for rapid finite fault modeling after earthquakes, and also, therefore, for tsunami alerts, certainly basin-wide, and hopefully eventually also fast and good enough so that it can be of use for local tsunamis, which can be such tragic human impacts. So also with volcanoes, real-time GPS and near real-time GPS can assist greatly, complement other instrumental data for monitoring the movement of magma within a volcanic system and for assessing volcano unrest and helping with ash cloud alerts as well. So clearly, we're highly motivated to be able to help more with real-time GPS. So going back to the early days of continuous GPS development, our efforts along with our partners in Southern California led through SCEC and the SIGN project, working with Scripps and JPL, with support from USGS, NSF, and NASA, and the WM Keck Foundation at the time. We built out a network that was sort of a precursor to the PBO, and at this point, of course, now we have a tremendous amount of built infrastructure already in place. We have many stations in the western U.S. that are, as Richard mentioned, we're building on top of that infrastructure. Most of this was done without real-time telemetry, but rather with dial-up telemetry so that on a daily basis we would download files and process daily. So we reached the point back in the mid-90s of having that all very well automated. So the challenge to us has been to now reach a similar level of sophistication, automation, robust performance, but for real-time GPS, and this has continued to be a challenge. So we're also kind of considering the mix of instrumentation. It's also been a challenge to co-locate seismic and geodetic instrumentation over the years, as I'm sure most of you know. In some cases, it may be beneficial in the future to also add gyros to the mix. But as we're building out new stations currently, we're focusing on putting in strong motion accelerometers along with GPS, and in the near field in particular, so that as we're building out along the San Andreas, for example, we're focusing in on that part of the instrumentation where we're trying to go towards less expensive instrumentation and more instruments in the near field. So these are some of the things we're working on. In particular, along the southern San Andreas fault, we have a fairly good geometry for doing earthquake early warning for the city of Los Angeles. So trying to get the cursor up. Anyway, you can see Los Angeles is labeled there. It's a big city. The San Andreas runs past it, not as close, of course, as it runs past San Francisco here, but close enough to be potentially very damaging in large earthquakes. So the Coachella Valley section in particular was identified back in the mid-80s as the most hazardous section of the San Andreas Fault for a big event that could potentially be damaging to LA. So our initial focus with the field instrumentation build-out has been to put in a zipper array along the San Andreas. This has been under Doug Givens' leadership and with multi-hazards funding from USGS. And we've, along that southern part where the southeastern yellow splash is, from there up to just east of Los Angeles, we've put an additional 15 or so stations that have seismic and GPS instrumentation together in the near field. So the hope is, and the approach is, that we are, at the same time, we're working on improving our algorithms, improving our telemetry so that we can make use of the real-time GPS results along with the seismic data for early warning. And we've been building out, as we've been able to, with the resources that we have, putting out more instrumentation, because we know that that's going to be an important part of the overall approach. And in the future, we're taking that same approach, but moving up to the northwest to the Carrizo Plain, we'll be putting additional instrumentation along that section of the San Andreas Fault as well, with the same idea in mind, that we realize we're putting a lot of resources into this additional instrumentation, and we can do that because we already have the benefit of spatial coverage throughout Southern California of high-quality seismic and geodetic instrumentation. So we now can take the next step of putting more eggs in these two baskets out along the San Andreas, where otherwise we wouldn't really be able to justify putting such purpose-built, specialized instrumentation out along San Andreas. So, but we are moving in that direction, putting more instrumentation out. Furthermore, we're looking for partnerships in the same vein that Richard Allen just mentioned about public-private partnerships. Some of the large governmental organizations, for example, Caltrans, as well as critical lifeline operators in the state, have pipelines, other infrastructure crossing the San Andreas and other faults. And so it makes sense to work with them more closely to try to develop these public-private partnerships and to put more instrumentation at these critical lifeline crossing points so that the utility operators get information quickly as an earthquake is occurring, and that may then be beneficial to them and also overall beneficial to the region to help with overall resiliency, because if there's a way to get more rapid information about damage to these critical lifelines, that can potentially even help with a more strategic approach to making those repairs and getting the lifeline systems back up and functioning sooner after a future earthquake. So the status of our work is that, of course, at USGS for global use through the USGS NEIC, ShakeMap, Pager, and other estimation of magnitude and CMT, as you've been hearing about at this meeting, These are highly evolved efforts, and for example, the finite fault source modeling that Gavin Hayes has been doing. But we do still have a need that we recognize to do even more with real-time GPS in particular, and feeding that into finite fault source modeling in near real-time and eventually even in real-time to get better source estimates quicker. And so the way to view this is that in a case with, like the San Andreas fault, if we can have GPS receivers in the near field on either side of the fault, we can even be detecting fault slip as it's occurring. So that's the overall idea of the finite, of the zipper array and how it could feed in directly to an early warning system in that way. Let's see, so we've been working on early warning and the incorporation of real-time GPS into early warning with a variety of partners over a long period of time here. We've supported some various efforts by different groups in academia and also some private sector groups for real-time processing software. The ongoing testing right now taking place at USGS Pasadena at Cascades Volcano Observatory and USGS in Menlo Park include current testing of the JPL Pure, the PPP solution through Yoaz Barsever's group and the GREAT project that was supported by NASA. So we've been testing that along with them for a few years. We're also testing RTNet, which is a private sector solution from GPS Solutions Incorporated. Currently we're testing their RTK algorithm and soon we'll be incorporating using their PPP algorithm as well. And we are also currently testing TrackRT, which was developed by Tom Herring at MIT, and that's a pure RTK solution. So the challenge remains to integrate the real-time GPS after we're done testing it, making sure that it's robust. We've been taking an approach that's scalable and that is also affordable and allows us to have a flexible system that we can use along with our existing instrumentation. Basically, we can't afford to swap out all of our receivers for the ones that are offered by a number of vendors now that will output real-time positions to within 5 centimeters. You can pick up your latest issue of GPS World or Inside GNSS and see a number of vendors claiming 5-centimeter global real-time capability, but that would require upgrading our whole network to specialized equipment, and we just can't do that approach. So they also tend to charge a lot for the real-time correction streams that are required by those types of receivers. So anyway, we're going with a different approach that we feel will be more scalable. We know that telemetry is crucial. If we have telemetry dropouts, we lose our position accuracy, and then it takes a while to get it back. So we have a number of technical challenges. So for real-time early warning, we know that for the San Andreas system, the RTK algorithms seem to work well, but we are concerned that for megathrust events, really big ones, that the far field displacements will result in movement of the reference stations. So RTK kind of breaks down. It's not ideal. Precise point positioning ought to work better for those applications in Pacific Northwest and Alaska, for example. Also, with real-time GPS processing, there's a strong advantage to waiting and then filtering in both directions through the data. You can get much more precise results with even a latency of a few minutes, whereas the truly real time, which we need for the early warning, is more coarse. So these are some things that there's no time to go into the details of, but just I'll mention that. Those are some of the challenges. For Southern California, where we're doing the real-time testing, I'll quickly show you some results here, but first of all, from the PSAP, COTD, WIDC, those are short baseline results, and then I'll show the longer baseline result, 230 kilometer from BOMG down in the southeast up to CIT1 at Caltech. So for the short baseline results, these next few graphs are in millimeters. So that's scatter in the blue and yellow, which are the horizontal components of roughly centimeter level over the 40 minutes. All three graphs you'll see here have a 40-minute scale. So that's this kind of scatter we're getting out of TrackRT, and really several RTK, pure RTK algorithms will give results like these on short baselines. That's not a problem.
Don't have much more time.
Okay. What's surprisingly good now in TrackRT in the latest version that we're now running is few centimeter level scatter over time periods of, in this case, 40 minutes, but we're seeing over many weeks' time we can get several centimeter scatter out of the RTK even at baselines of 230 kilometers like this one. The RTNet solutions are shown just an example here, similar levels of scatter with their RTK engine, so these we feel are working pretty well. We're just about feeling ready for prime time with them. Over a longer period of time, 3 days here, these plots show RTNet output as well, but you can see that there are these big excursions from time to time, and that's what makes us realize we really need to do more work on automation and integration with the seismic data. So that's some of the challenges I mentioned. And I won't get into this in any detail, but of course also this is applicable to volcano monitoring, and we do a lot of that too. So we're trying to come up with solutions that work well for earthquakes and volcanoes. The last point I'd really like to make here with my conclusion slide is just that as we bring new technologies into use, they need to be proven through testing to be robust and reliable. And really a structured approach like what's used for the Air Force with the GPS satellites themselves is to bring things up through technology readiness levels. This is a very structured system that's used before launching satellites. So my work on the L1C GPS signal with the Air Force, I was familiarized with this general approach, and I can tell you it takes much higher levels of funding to take a structured approach like that. But as Richard Allen was saying, as we go through the prototyping phases and then into the eventual operational deployment of an early warning system, I think we really need to get serious about approaching it in this more structured way. And then eventually we would love to be able to really use real-time GPS along with seismic data for all of these natural hazard alerts. So thank you very much.
Is there a lightning question out there? Okay, well, thank you. Oh, wait, well, I still can't see. Okay.
For Cascadia, is there real-time GPS that would indicate both vertical and horizontal motions at the coast?
Yeah, I can address that. No, I'll keep it quick. So, yeah, so NSF has been funding real-time telemetry at a large number of the PBO stations in the Pacific Northwest, and the Panga Consortium has been doing real-time GPS for years. Tim Melbourne has been speaking about this, for example, and the UW part of the early warning effort for the western U.S. region, there's great interest in doing more with that. So Tim Melbourne is one of the leading groups on the real-time GPS processing right now. So that's coming along really well.
Yeah. All right.
Thanks.
Sam, thank you. Okay, so let's move along since we're a little slow. So the next speaker will be Aldo Zolo, and he'll talk about the earthquake early warning system in southern Italy, performance tests, and the next developments.
Yep. So to go forward. Okay, thank you. So, in Italy, a dense network of accelerometric stations is deployed over all the national territory, covering the most high-risky zones. As you can see from this picture, with red dots there, this network has the potential for a nationwide early warning system, but actually is not running in real time. And so it needs to expand to the real-time mode. In southern Italy, several years ago, it's 5 years from now, started a project for the implementation and testing of an early warning system where new technologies for real-time data acquisition and processing are being tested and applied. So the network consists in a number of physical subnets which are collecting data to some local control centers and distributing and sharing the data among the other control centers to a network control centers, which is actually enables the Department of Physics. We selected different data transmission modes. Essentially, we used standard DSL, UMTS, and Wi-Fi for the transmission of data. Each site is equipped with three components, seismometers. One is velocity meters, and the other one is accelerometers. So the data are continuously streamed in real time by using the Seedlink protocol to a center where a platform, a software platform is running, which is called Presto. And this platform is aimed at the data acquisition, real-time processing, or release of the principal information, either on the basis of parametric information or the full waveform information. So Presto is the acronym of probabilistic and evolutionary early warning systems that, as I told you, is a software platform which consists of a number of modules which are dedicated to different tasks of the early warning process in real time. We have automatic pinging, then real time probabilistic earthquake locations after one station is recording the first P waves, then we have real time magnitude estimations, and finally these data are included in ground motion prediction equations to get peak ground motion at sites. This platform has been recently upgrading to include a threshold method which provides alert levels and alert levels at the site of the network. This new development is based on the acquisition, simultaneous acquisition and processing of two early warning parameters. One is the peak displacement in 3 seconds peak time wind of on vertical component, and the initial period parameters. So several studies have shown that that tau c is a proxy for magnitude, while pd is can provide estimation of the peak ground velocity. So you can set up based on threshold values of these two parameters a decision table, which gives you an alert at your sites, defining whether the occurring earthquake is dangerous or not for the sites where the measurement is done. So we are in a rather low rate seismicity regions. We have recorded maximum magnitude 3.5 earthquakes over the last 3 years. And so we have to develop a number of strategies for testing the performance of the of these systems, which is likely to work only once in its life. We developed, therefore, different approaches. The first one is offline scenario testing based on data recorded in Italy or in Japan, but also using synthetic waveforms for extended and finite source earthquake models. And the other approach is use a standard statistical performance about the success, missed alarm, or false alarm. And we apply this to offline studies in Japan and in Italy. So as concerning the scenario studies, we developed a visualization tool for the Presto, which we use to playback data in real time and to study the evolution of our the evolution of the information as the data came into the network. And in this picture here, I show a screenshot of these visualization tools. Actually, it's you can run in as a movie. This is for the L'Aquila earthquake and offline application to the data which have been recorded by the national network acceleration network for these events. So the information that are provided here are the alert levels with numbers and the expected lead time at specific sites and the expected amplitude of the ground motion in terms of acceleration, but also you can have the timeline of the magnitude estimations and also the position of the earthquake as a function of time. So we did this kind of scenario study using synthetic data. This is the case for an earthquake of magnitude 7 occurring in east of Sicily, or we did for using actual records of Japan Noto Anto earthquake of magnitude 6.7 in 2007. So, as concerning the threshold method, we have recently worked on the last decade, magnitude greater than 6 events in Japan, and we tested the methodology for the evaluation of the threshold early warning approach. Here is a comparison of the potential damage zone as expressed by the peak displacement and intensity as computed by JMA, or intensity, instrumental intensity as inferred from the PGV. And these examples show that the real-time estimation of the potential damage zone match fairly well the final high shake zone as represented by this shake map. But to be more quantitative, we computed the number of successful alarms, missed alarms, and false alarms based on the matching between the predicted and the observed instrumental intensity. And in this plot, you can see that over this very large database of Japanese earthquake, we have an 87% of successful alarms, while a significant number of false alarms, 11.9%, and very few missed alarms. If we look into detail at this false alarm, we see that most of them are associated to overestimation of the intensity of 1 or 2 degrees. So it's clearly dependent, critically dependent on the relationship that you use between intensity and the ground motion parameter you are dealing with. So we try to do the same thing for our network, which is recording during these last five years only small earthquakes. In this case, of course, we cannot use intensity as a measurement, but we compare we assessed the successful or false or missed alarm based on the of the detection of the event, location, and magnitude. And as you can see in this plot, we have again a good number of successful, but even in this case, we have a number of false alarms. We know that these false alarms come essentially from misidentification of storms, which are frequently during the winter in our network, or from recordings on teleseismics, which are attributed as low magnitude events in our networks.
Two more minutes.
Okay, I'm finished. Okay. So here is a distribution of magnitude on our network, and most important, we could evaluate for the city of Naples, based on the earthquake that we have recorded, which is the expected distribution of lead times for earthquakes occurring along the Irpinian regions, and this can give an idea of how much time is available for any the early warning application to the city of Naples, and for earthquakes occurring in this region of the Apennines. I conclude, so our system Presto has evolved toward an integrated regional and on-site system and provides multiple information in real time, earthquake location, magnitude, predicted P ground motion levels, alert levels, and so on. All these information are actually sent out in two ways, in the, by email and SMS, and are updated in real time at the control room of the civil protections in Rome. Future implementation of the is in southern Spain, South Korea, and on the national accelerometry network. The system performance that we have done show that the results are quite encouraging, but we have a number of false alarm, which is significant to work on. Thank you.
Okay, is there any quick questions? All right, okay, well, thank you very much. All right, getting a little closer back to schedule here. The next talk will be empirical relationships between tau P max and MW, tau C and MW for the Marmara region with H. Alchik, C. Zulfikar, and M. Erdik with C. Zulfikar speaking. In fact, are the speakers here? We may be right back on schedule. So, no speakers? All right, so I think we have a very short break because the next talk is scheduled to begin. Oh, wait a minute, we have two talks at the same time. 11:05? Our schedule is confused. So, moving on quickly to the second talk scheduled for 11:05. We will hear End User Applications of Real-Time Earthquake Information in Europe by Georgia Kuo. Sorry about the confusion.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you, John. How do I advance the slides?
I think we're going to give you this mouse as soon as we get things started. Okay.
Okay. Good morning.
There's a pointer.
Okay.
And this thing will count down.
Countdown. Yeah. Great. Thank you. So today I'll be talking about planned European developments in real-time seismology that are taking place as part of this new EU project called REACT. REACT stands for Strategies and Tools for Real-Time Earthquake Risk Reduction. And this is a three-year EU project that started in September 2011. So we're only a few months into the project at the moment, so mostly I'll talk about the goals of the project. And we can take bets on how much of this we will actually accomplish by 2014. So the participants come from 18 European countries, two from the Eastern Caribbean, US, Japan, and Taiwan. There are a few main features of the project that I would like to emphasize. First of all, the primary focus is on optimized use of real-time earthquake information with a focus on applications at specific sites. And the timescales that are involved are medium to short-term earthquake forecasting in the months to minutes before the event, early warning in the seconds after the event, then shake maps and rapid loss estimation in the minutes to hours after the event. At all stages of this chain, we would like to have realistic uncertainty estimates so that information can be combined in a probabilistic decision-making framework that would allow the users to make the optimal decision in real time. There are 12 applications in Europe where this end-to-end risk reduction chain will be applied, and the end users are involved from the very beginning. We can't really talk about real-time seismology in Europe without mentioning the SAFER project. The SAFER was an earlier EU-funded project, also a three-year project that started in June 2006. REACT is a direct descendant of this project. The goal of this project was to develop real-time tools for protecting European cities, and these were the test sites that were included. At the end of the SAFER project, Aldo Zalo's group had a prototype system of Presto running in Naples, virtual seismologists had been implemented by ETH, and we were testing this in real time in Switzerland and California. Athens had a significantly upgraded real-time network, and there were improved shake map generating capabilities in Istanbul and Cairo. And Istanbul was also running a prototype SOSUIN system. So at the end of the SAFER project, the partners made first contacts with potential end users, and they essentially told these end users, look, these are the interesting types of information that we can provide you. Why don't you think about what you'd like to do with them while we try to get more funding? And this is essentially where we are with React. We start with a dialogue between the academic and the end user partners, and we're bringing together a group of seismologists, engineers, computer scientists, economists, and the end users in trying to ask, how can real-time earthquake information be optimally used? So finally, to the 12 applications that I will be talking about. Yes, there are indeed 12, but it's okay, I'll talk fast. Each of these 12 applications use some sort of early warning algorithm. The options available are the Presto algorithm from Naples, Virtual Seismologist from ETH, the Istanbul Rapid Response and Early Warning System, as well as customized on-site approaches. And some of these are feasibility studies, while others are actual real-time installations. So I'll start with five applications that involve real-time algorithms running at the networks. First of all, we have nuclear plants in Switzerland. The partner here is Swiss Nuclear. They maintain four nuclear plants in Switzerland that provide 40% of Swiss energy needs. And the goal of this project is to have a real-time installation of the virtual seismologist running on the national networks and sending information in real-time to control rooms at the nuclear plants. They're also interested in how earthquake forecast information can be useful for them. Next is a pilot project on how to early warning information can be used at schools. This is a project led by Aldo Zollo's group in Amra and also involves the Geoforschungszentrum Potsdam. And they're partnering with two schools near Naples. These schools will be receiving real-time information from the system that Aldo described in his talk. There are also going to be additional on-site installations at the schools, and the information from the stations at the sites will be combined with the information from the regional network in the Presto Plus algorithm that Aldo's group is working on. The emphasis of this application is how to optimize human response to early warning information. Next, we have power plants and power transmission networks in Iceland. In this application, the Icelandic Meteorological Office will work with Landsvirkjun and Landsnet. These are the hydropower plant operators in Iceland. They produce 75% of Iceland's electricity. Landsnet is the power transmission company, and they take the electricity from the hydro plants to the users. All of their facilities are at risk from magnitude 7.3 events on the South Iceland seismic zone, which have a return period of about 100 years. And in this application, they're interested in a real-time STEP application as well as an initial real-time virtual seismologist installation. Next, we have early warning for the city of Patras, which is in western Greece, with a special focus on the Rhean Antirrhian Bridge. The University of Patras operates a modern seismic network in this region, and they would like to run a virtual seismologist installation and send information to the bridge operators. This is a special bridge. This is the Rhean Antirrhian Bridge is the longest multi-span cable-stayed bridge in the world. It's 2.8 kilometers long. It was constructed by the Yefira Consortium, and they're the ones who are responsible for operating the bridge. So they'd like to receive real-time information. And the Civil Protection Authority of Western Greece is also involved and would also like to receive real-time information. Next, we have natural gas distribution network, as well as the Fatih Sultan Mehmet Bridge, both in Istanbul. The partners here are the Kandili Observatory in Istanbul, Geoforschungszentrum Potsdam, as well as the plants and the bridge. So IGDAS, the gas distribution plant, is the main natural gas provider in Istanbul. They operate 9,000 kilometers of gas distribution lines. They have a pretty sophisticated supervisory at control and data acquisition system. This is a SCADA system that monitors the health of their distribution network. And they would like to interface this monitoring system with the Istanbul Early Warning Rapid Response Network. And for the bridge, the Fatih Sultan Mehmet Bridge is one of the two bridges connecting the crossing the Bosporus Straits. And Kandili Observatory and GFZ would like to install at least 20 SOSA wind stations on this bridge for real-time structural health monitoring. Finally, we move to three industrial facilities. These facilities will mainly have on-site installations that would most likely use threshold-based approaches. All of there's a complex in Portugal, as well as the port and the hospital in Thessaloniki. And all of these facilities are rather large with several buildings on them. They have several critical subsystems that they want to protect. For instance, telecommunication systems, water distribution, electricity, waste distribution, waste processing plants. And the focus on this application is on real-time risk reduction. So they like to combine time-dependent hazard estimates with time-dependent fragility functions and come up with shake maps and real-time loss estimates, and also try to optimize their emergency response plans after large events. I close with three feasibility studies. The first is a feasibility study that will be conducted by the AMRA group in Naples. They are partnering with the Circumvesuviana Railway, who operate the... they would like to protect this portion of the track between Naples and Baiano. This portion of the track is at risk from repeats of the magnitude 6.9 Campania-Lucania earthquake. And their feasibility study is actually quite interesting. It's a combination of early warning, semi-active control, and real-time health monitoring. So if possible, they would like early warning information to trigger some semi-active control to protect the viaducts along this line. And if health monitoring shows that the viaducts are damaged, they want to automatically stop the trains. Aldo has already described the efforts that will take place with the RAN network in Italy, so I won't talk about that. And finally, we have a feasibility study for a possible regional early warning system in the Eastern Caribbean. And this is a partnership between EU Center in Pavia and University of West Indies. So in lieu of conclusions, I'll leave you with a list of other expected results. I haven't given you a comprehensive overview of the project. I've only discussed the parts that have to do with the end users. There are a lot of other efforts planned. For instance, there's a component on understanding the relationship between transients and triggering large earthquakes. This will be led by Pascal Bernard. There's a work package on development of next-generation earthquake forecast models coordinated by Warner Marzocchi. Aldo Zalo is leading a work package on improving early warning methodologies, and this includes a component on citizen seismic networks, which will be led by Remy Bossu. And there's development of methodologies for real-time, time-dependent risk assessment led by Kyriassis Pitilakis. Finally, there's the part on optimized decision-making. This is led by Thomas Leguenan and his group of economists. And ultimately, this multidisciplinary consortium is getting together to ask the question, how do we optimally use real-time earthquake information? And I hope that come 2014, we will have some success stories to share with you. Thank you.
All right, Eddie, could you come to the microphone?
Thank you for the presentation, and I have a quick question. That you mentioned application example in Istanbul for the bridge, and you mentioned that you embedded the algorithm into their health monitoring system. So I was wondering how you embedded your algorithm into their monitoring system, because I think they use different sensors like the fiber optical sensors or some other sensors. You install new sensors, or you use their sensors to do that?
So this effort, that particular effort, is part of the Kandili Observatory, and actually the group who was supposed to be here, we would have heard from them. But they already have a monitoring system that includes different kinds of sensors, but they would like to receive early warning information. And how they do that is a question that has yet to be resolved. But that it's the same thing for the nuclear plants. They also have seismometers, but they have also a whole slew of other instruments that are monitoring different parts of the plant. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. No more questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
And we'll remember to reset it this time. So the next talk will be results from the Quake Catcher Network Rapid Aftershock Mobilization Program in Christchurch, New Zealand, given by A.I. Chung.
Good morning. Let's just get acquainted here. My name is Angela Chung, and I'm going to be talking to you today about the Quake Catcher Network and some of the exciting results that we've got so far from our Rapid Aftershock Mobilization Program in Christchurch, New Zealand. The Quake Catcher Network is a very diverse project, and we currently have collaborators from numerous fields applying QCN data to numerous other fields. Today, however, I'll be focusing primarily on the seismological side of things and how we can rapidly detect earthquakes using the Quake Catcher Network. The Quake Catcher Network is an innovative seismic network that uses low-cost accelerometers and volunteer computers to record earthquakes. The goal of our network is to increase the number of seismic recordings by installing thousands of QCN sensors around the world in order to better improve our understanding of earthquake science and earthquake hazards. We currently use two different types of accelerometers. The first are those that are in newer Apple and ThinkPad laptops. Now, these are built into the computers, so they don't cost us anything, and all the participant has to do is download our free software, and then they're ready to go. The second type of sensor that we use are low-cost USB sensors. They're very small, about the size of a matchbox, and they plug into the computer using a USB. We have a few different models with varying sensitivities, and they cost in the range of about $30 to $150. The primary requirements for our stations are power and a computer with internet access, and as such, there are no maintenance costs, and we don't have to service our stations, which is some of the reasons why we've been able to expand our network so dramatically. The sensors are very easy to install. It takes about 10 minutes to install a station. And the Quake Catcher Network is also very useful for educational purposes. We can use our sensors along with our downloadable program QCN Live to teach K through 12 students all about earthquakes. It's also really great for any of our volunteers because it allows them to be part of important scientific discovery. This is a map of our current seismic network. We have about 2,000 stations around the world in 67 countries, and we've recorded earthquakes ranging between a magnitude 2.5 and a magnitude 8.8. Now a little bit about our triggering. So when the significance or the signal-to-noise ratio on the side here. When the significance goes above a certain threshold, then we say there's been a trigger. And the computer then sends that data that it records to our servers. And this part's very important. A lot of the rapid earthquake detection that we do uses only this trigger data, which includes only a very minimal amount of information. So instead of waiting for the whole waveform, which is very large and we'd have to wait for all the shaking to stop, we only send that very minimal packet of information to our servers. So we are, of course, assuming that the peak acceleration at the time of the trigger scales similarly to the overall peak acceleration. And as I'll show in a minute, that seems to be working very well. And of course, as we'd like to maximize the number of actual earthquake triggers and minimize the number of false triggers, as these are in people's homes, and so there's children running around and people jumping up and down, doors slamming, etc. So we, of course, having a well-tested triggering algorithm is, of course, essential. This is just an example of a magnitude 3.2 earthquake at the on the side here. One of our biggest hindrances or obstacles with data, one of our biggest obstacles with the rapid earthquake detection is data latency. So although we're only sending a very minimal amount of data to our servers, it still takes a finite amount of time to record that data and then to send it to our servers. The average amount of time in California is about 3.6 seconds, and elsewhere in the world it's about 4.3 seconds. A few other important details. Location, as we often send our sensors to our participants around the world, in order to accurately locate the earthquakes, we need to know where the stations are located. And the initial location is based on the user's IP address. And then, as this can be a little inaccurate, we encourage the participant to put a more accurate location in using a Google Maps interface. And then the second important topic is timing. Unlike a traditional seismometer, ours do not contain a GPS unit to help them keep perfect time. And unfortunately, the clocks that our sensors are attached to, the clocks on the computers can tend to drift over time. So instead, we use a system called the Network Time Protocol. And this, the clocks on each of the stations are synchronized to a reference station. And this has worked very well for us. In fact, some of our recent studies have shown it to be accurate down to about 2 milliseconds, so it's working nicely. Now the fun part, the QCN Rapid Aftershock Mobilization Projects. And so far we've had two of these ramps, the goals of which have been to deploy as many sensors as possible after a major earthquake in order to record aftershocks, to then use this data to rapidly detect, to test our rapid detection algorithms, and also for ground motion amplification studies. And the first of these projects that we did was in Chile after the magnitude 8.8 earthquake last year. And we took about 100 sensors and installed them up and down the coast. It was a very broad network, so we were covered several hundred kilometers. But now this new network, the Christchurch network, that we installed after the magnitude 7.1 earthquake last September, is a much denser network. So I took 200 sensors with me on a plane. I just stuck them in a duffel bag, jumped on the plane. Just a few days after the earthquake. And with the help of GNS, we installed 192 sensors in and around Christchurch in 8 days. And most, like I said, this is much more dense, and we had most of them within about a 10-kilometer radius of the city. So as I mentioned before, when the significance goes over threshold, we get a trigger. And this trigger mesh is then sent to our server, and the server then looks for other triggers within 100 seconds and 200-kilometer radius of that trigger. It then checks the move out to see if that wave is traveling at a valid seismic velocity. And if the number of triggers is greater than a regional threshold, then we get a detection. And on the right here, we have an example of, of one of our alert maps, which I'll get into in just a moment. So after the detection is issued, we then go on to estimate the location. And to do this, we grid search and iterate to find the best location using either P or S wave arrivals. And we then calculate the magnitude. To do this, we use a vector sum of the peak ground acceleration on the three components. And we update this amplitude with as the shaking continues for a few seconds afterwards. We use an empirical distance magnitude relationship. And this is actually something I've been working on quite a bit lately. So what I did was I took all the data from any of our events, the QCN events that we had that matched up with GNS events, and performed an inversion, and then came up with a new relationship where M is the final event magnitude, P of tau is the peak ground acceleration at time tau, where tau is the number of time after seconds after the P wave, and delta is the station to hypocenter distance, so we're using hypocenter here. And as I'll show in a bit, this is working very well. For those of you who are more visual, we have this plot. It's a little bit difficult to see, but basically on the right-hand side, we have the log peak ground acceleration, which is the color. And then as you can see on the top here, the shaking increases quickly with time after the P wave and, of course, decreases with distance from the hypercenter. We really began testing of robust testing of our rapid earthquake detections with the Christchurch network. And one of the things we did was create a website where real-time detections were posted. And this is an example of one of those web pages. As soon as a new detection is made, a new page is made for that event. And then as we get more information from more sensors, as the shaking expands out from the source, we can then use those other station shaking trigger information to update our preliminary estimates. So at the bottom of this page, we can see previous estimates. In the middle here is the alert map that I'll explain in a moment. And at the top, we can see the final earthquake location and magnitude. And we can compare this to the official GeoNet, GNS results on the right. And it's really small writing, so it's hard to see. But our magnitude is 4.49. Theirs is 4.5. Our depth is 11.9. Theirs is 11. Our longitude is right on, and our latitude is about a tenth of a degree off. So I would consider this to be very good. And again, we're only using that very initial trigger information for these for this results. So for our maps of estimated shaking, we extrapolate the current shaking to all other locations. And this is an example of the alert map that was created for the Christchurch event. There we go. This one for the, so the magnitude 6.3 earthquake this past February. This was detected on 14 sensors in about 7 seconds. Our final magnitude was a 5.7 at the top here. But we can compare this to the official USGS shake map and see that they are in very good agreement. We can also compare the peak ground acceleration of the overall waveform between the QCN stations, which are the round ones, and the GeoNet stations, which are the square ones. And we can see here that in some places it's actually difficult to tell the difference between the two because they're in very good agreement with each other. So we've been performing our real-time detection since about mid-September 2010. At the moment, most of our detections are in New Zealand. We have just a few in California after we've been doing a recent network expansion here. And this is because no other network, no other location currently has enough stations or enough earthquakes to test these algorithms. As we can see in the upper left-hand corner here, most of the detections occur within about 7 to 10 seconds from the earthquake origin time. And the initial results from our testing has proven to be very successful. We can show that with this new relationship, the new scaling relationship, that about 95% of our earthquake magnitude estimates are within one magnitude of the GNS reported values, 80% are within a half a magnitude, and 55% are within a quarter magnitude. And this is very promising, especially considering that we are using these lower quality seismometers, basically sensors, but because of our dense network spacing, we're able to make up for that fact. And we've also been able to show that we are able to create a working seismic network for a fraction of the cost of a traditional network. We've also been working on an alert, an email alert. And so as soon as we get a detection, we get an email in our inbox to give us the specs about that earthquake. And I'd like to say thank you, especially to all of our participants and all of our volunteers, especially those who have helped with our network distribution in California, in Chile, and New Zealand. Thank you.
All right, do we have any questions? All right, then let's move on to the next talk. Thank you very much. Okay, well, the next talk will be near real-time full-wave centroid moment tensor inversion for ground motion forecasts in a three-dimensional Earth for Southern California, given by E. Lee. Let's see, we'll give you the mouse here in a second.
Okay, thank you.
And yeah, here's the
pointer
with the button there.
Good morning. Today I'm going to present our research near real-time four-wave central moment tensor inversion for ground motion forecast in 3D earthquake structure of Southern California. And basically the main idea is divided by my advisor, Paul Chen, and we really appreciate the Argonne National Lab provide a computational resource and the support from SCAC. So, in our title, full wave turn actually means we we solve the wave equation using a viscoelastic wave equation using a numerical method rather than just approximation. So as we know, the ground motion recording is a convolution among source structure and instrument response, and then we know the instrument response. So the advantage of a full wave method is can simulate the wave propagation in a three-dimensional structure, for example, like a Bayesian amplification effect. And then you also can put the more complex structure in your source term. So this full wave give you a best estimation for source and the wave propagation in complex structure, so you get a more accurate ground motion estimation, and it's very useful for seismic hazard analysis. So basically, currently, probably there are two types of ground motion forecast. For long term, there's a probabilistic seismic hazard map. So this kind of map give you an idea of a probability of ground motion exceeding a certain level and in like long term, like 50 years. It's very useful for earthquake engineering. And currently in SCAC, there is a CyberShack project, and their seismic hazard map is based on full wave method. So in their simulation, they do a simulation in a complex 3D structure, and then they use a earthquake rupture model in their source term. So here is their result for Los Angeles region, and you can see they have some higher hazard level in Los Angeles region, and they provide more detail in Los Angeles region. And for short term, there is the earthquake early warning system. In Southern California, like there's the ELERM proposed by Allen in 2007. The best idea is they use a first arrive P, the time information to locate an earthquake, and the spectral information for estimate magnitude, and then apply the radio attenuation relationship for ground motion estimation. So here we propose a full wave near real-time ground motion forecast. So our goal is to get a fast and accurate ground motion forecast. And in our full wave method, there are two required elements. One is an accurate 3D structure model, and it give you some complex structure in your region, for example, like Los Angeles Basin and other basins. And another requirement is that we need a very rapid source inversion algorithm. So in this case, we do a CMT inversion, but it's possible to extend to a higher order source estimation. And once you have these two elements, you can get a fast and accurate ground motion forecast. And first, I will talk about our structure model, and then talk about how we did the source inversion. So we also work on the waveform tomography for Southern California, and this is currently we've done a nice iteration, and this is a one slide at 2 kilometers. And in our model, we have lots of basins and great valleys, and we can in our model we also see some discontinued velocity gap across the folds. So here I just want to show some waveform improvement compared with initial model. For example, the black line represents low pass data seismogram, then red line represents synthetic. The upper one is generally based on our updated model. The lower one is the initial model. So actually, those improvement in structure, and here's more. So actually, this improvement in structure model could give you a better estimation on ground motion prediction. For example, like this one, like an initial model probably is not that accurate, but like our update could make those ground motion prediction more accurate. So for the source inversion part, actually we published one paper in GGI, and for earthquake early warning, we just do some modification. So first, assume we have some real-time data. and then we detect a big earthquake. And then we just use a wavelength of first arrival energy from from stations, and then we do a normalized cross correlation between the data and synthetic seismogram, and then we extract those some information like a normalized cross correlation represent the waveform similarity and the time shift between the data and synthetic seismogram, and the amplitude ratio between data and synthetic seismogram, and then we apply Bayesian inference on those measurement and find an optimal solution. And once we have a solution, we can generate a shack map in very short time. So to generate synthetic seismogram efficiently, basically we store those called receiver green tensor. So the idea of a receiver green tensor is we put three orthogonal force at the receiver, and then store the wave field. So if we want to generate synthetic seismogram from any point in this model to this station based on reciprocity, you can do that in very short time. And then we also use Kuchi and Kamori's idea. Their idea is any moment tensor is a linear combination of this six elementary moment tensor. So in that case, we don't need to generate a synthetic seismogram for lots of solution. We just need to store the synthetic seismogram for this six elementary moment tensor in memory and just adjust this coefficient. We can get a synthetic seismogram for any moment tensor. So as we mentioned before, like we use those first arrived waveform and make some measurement, and then we apply Bayesian inference on those measurements. And here we assume those measurements are independent. So in this formula, this P represents a possibility, and the H represents the hypothesis. In our case, it's source parameter solutions, and the E as evidence. In our case, is those measurements. So at the beginning, we assume those possibilities for different solutions is the same, and basically this term is normalization term. So the possibility is proportional to this conditional probability, and if we just this figure shows like if there are five, we use a five waveforms, and their probability density functions look like. So if you just you look at any of one, is the uncertainty is very large. But as time goes by, you get for example, you get a five waveforms, and it comes out your uncertainty is smaller. But the uncertainty will reduce once you get more information, more waveforms. So here is just an example for Yerba-Linda earthquake, and those are the marginal probability for different source parameter destructive break. And so once we get a CMT, and we can generate a four-wave ground motion map in very short time. And this four-wave ground motion map gave you some idea about the wave propagation effect, like a Bayesian amplification effect and churn. So here is an example. The earthquake happened in the southern trough, but you can see those there is a big ground motion in Los Angeles region, and we can see that also in our synthetic. So it's reflect those Bayesian amplification effect. So for near real time. Test. Currently, we just done a test for using a Chino Hill earthquake, and we used about the 10 second for the first 10 second, and before the energy P energy go into a Los Angeles Bayesian, and then we find an optimal and solution in 20 seconds using the four cores. And actually, the time could be reduced. Like, for example, we just use a less station, like probably three or five or even less. But the uncertainty could be larger. So to summarize it, here in our in our method, we use a four-wave method. So this four-wave method give you a better estimation of wave propagation in complex 3D structure. And if you have a higher order structure model, you can put that in and get a better estimation for source. And we think there are two important elements in earthquake warning. One is we probably want to provide accurate ground motion prediction. And here we use a four-wave method to give you a better estimation for ground motion prediction. And that is we want to provide timing warning. So our source inversion method has potential to do that. And I think the important for accurate ground motion is like once a big earthquake happened, you want to get an idea of what's going on in that location, in certain region, not just shut down everything, but you have an idea about what's the ground motion, and you can make decision bet on that estimation. So for individual, probably there's a big earthquake. Do I need to bring my beer and food and find a place too high, or is just not that serious in my location? And in the future, probably you want to quantify those uncertainty in ground motion forecast. So our Bayesian inference have some uncertainty in for your source parameter, and as time goes by, you get more information, the uncertainty will less, and you have confidence in your estimation. And probably you need to also consider uncertainty in structure, also a source parameter into your ground motion forecast. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any questions out there? I just had a quick question. Isn't nonlinearity in strong earthquakes built into these methods?
Currently, it's possible. You mean like for like really large, probably you need the CMT could not represent that. But yeah, it's possible. Once you get an accurate CMT, it's possible to extend to a higher order estimation.
Well, actually, I was thinking of nonlinearity and the ground motion from the site effects near the receivers.
Yeah. Actually, this four-wave method do consider those like a Bayesian implication effect or side effect in it. Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. We have one more talk in the session. An automatic system for real-time determination of earthquake focal mechanism and ground motion in Taiwan by L. Zhao. Here's your mouse. Here's the button.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Today I'm going to talk about a computational system. I'm going to talk about a computational system we are developing in Taiwan for the purpose of quickly determine the earthquake focal mechanism and strong ground motion. And this system serves two purposes. One is for emergency response after an earthquake by providing a quick assessment of seismic hazard and the source properties of the earthquake, and also by providing a quickly providing scientific and reliable information for public dissemination. And the second purpose is for routine research for the earthquake source properties, finite source properties. And so to predict the ground motion, we need several things. First, we need a model for the earthquake source. And in our system, we can use both point source and finite source for larger earthquakes. And secondly, we need a model for the earth structure. And this structure includes a 3D velocity structure and also the surface topography. And thirdly, we need an efficient algorithm to model the wave propagation in the 3D earth structure. And for this, we use a non-staggered finite difference method. And finally, we need to consider the nonlinear site effect. And for this, we use amplification factors based on the VS30 velocity distribution. And also, this amplification factor is frequency dependent. So in our system, it's relatively easy to implement the 3D Earth model and the surface topography. and also the nonlinear side effects into the system. So our major efforts are spent on the determination of 3D of the focal mechanism, and also to simulate the ground motion in 3D Earth. So first, this is the system, the flow chart for determining the automatically determining the focal mechanisms, and the system is automatically triggered by the alert from the earthquake early warning system. And then the system, after the system is triggered, it remove it automatically cuts the data from the stations, from the recordings, and then remove the instrument responses and rotate the horizontal components to R and T components, and then it feeds this iterative process to in a grid search for the best focal mechanism, source depths, and moment magnitude that gives you the best fit to the waveforms until it reaches the satisfactory result and output the result, and then it triggers the automatic ground motion prediction system. And this shows an example for the focal mechanism determination by this cut and paste method developed by Zhu and Hamburger in 1996. So this method cuts the three-component seismogram into five windows, including two windows for the P wave on vertical and radial components, and three windows for the S wave, for shear waves. And for a number of trial source depths, it conducts a grid search for the focal mechanism that gives you the best waveform fits. Here shows the best the example for the best source depths. And here the black lines are the recorded seismograms, and red are the synthetics. And so each row is a station, and you have for each station you have five windows. And the automatic system will reject the phases with large misfits or smaller correlations between the synthetic and the records. And then it does this automatic iterative process until all the stations, all the phases have the correlations above certain threshold. And this can be done in about 2 to 3 minutes. So this shows an example. We have a web page at the Taiwan Earthquake Center, and displaying the results for all the automatic, all the results from the automatic system. So here is this example for this earthquake on the eastern coast of Taiwan, and this shows the result from the CAP method with the waveform fits. And after we have the focal mechanism solutions, we can predict the ground motion using the focal mechanism. And to predict the ground motion, what we need to do is to solve the seismic wave equation, and it's basically a combination of the equation of motion or the second Newton's law and the Hooke's law. So here this F is the body force representing the earthquake action, and we are solving this displacement U, and this stress is related by the Hooke's law with the displacement. So to solve this equation in a 3D structure model, we have to use a purely numerical method, and here we use this fourth order non-staggered finite difference method developed by Zhang and Chen in 2006. And this method can deal with a 3D structure model and also the surface topography. So for some numerical considerations, here is this box shows the area that we are trying to model. And this dots shows the horizontal grid points. And spatially, we use 500 meters horizontal grid spacing, and vertical grid spacing is variable. So it's at the surface, it's 500 meters, and at greater depths, it's bigger. And the time sampling rate is about 18 milliseconds. And we use this latest tomography model by Guo Chen and Wu, using the newest, the most recent Tiger data. And for this model, with this spatial spacing and time sampling rate, we can get accurate waveforms for all the seismic waves longer than 3 second period. So our modeling range is 250 kilometers by 400 kilometers, and the depth range is from the surface to 80 kilometer depths. And we are calculating the time series for 120 seconds. So this represents about 51 million spatial grid points and 6,700 time steps. And this requires 64 cores and 6 hours time. And the output files generated in what each simulation is about 15 gigabytes. So this is definitely not real time. So our approach to make it more efficient is by this is to exploit the reciprocity property of the Green's functions. So this is the usual way that we use to get a seismogram at a point at a station R. So if we want the seismogram at station R from this earthquake at S, we just run the simulation from the source. And with each simulation, we get the response at all the grid points. And so if we need the response at this point, we just retrieve it from the result. But we can, this takes 6 hours, so it's not real time. But if we use the reciprocity, then we can make this process faster. So in using this way, if we want the seismogram at this point, we can run the simulation from this point. And with this simulation, we get all the Green's functions from all the grid points to this point. So if we have an earthquake at some point, we can just retrieve the Green's function. And then the seismogram will be just the multiplication of the Green's function with the moment tensor. So with this approach, if we can pre-calculate the Green's function for this point, then and store the Green's functions on the disk, then no matter where there's an earthquake, we can just quickly retrieve the Green's function and get the seismogram very quickly. And so this, when you calculate the seismograms, you don't need to do the simulation again, so it's very fast. And if you can calculate the Green's functions for many, many points on the surface and store them, then no matter where you have an earthquake, you can quickly get the ground motion results very quickly. So here shows this red dot shows the grid points that we established the Green's function database for Taiwan. They are all the on-land grid points. And these are the previous numbers for the simulations. So here the red dots, there are about 2,300 grid points. So, and because the ground motion is three-dimensional, so at each point, we need three simulations to calculate the Green's functions. And so we need about 7,000 simulations to calculate all the Green's functions. And this takes about 41,000 hours on 64 core cluster. And the total output files is about 100 terabytes. But after you finish all this calculation and have the Green's function database, then no matter where you have an earthquake in this region, you can get all the ground motion on, at all the grid points on the surface very quickly. And this shows the topography that we use in our Green's function calculations. This is from the GTOPO 30. So the resolution, horizontal resolution, is about 1 kilometer. And this is the VS 30 map for Taiwan. So basically this central and eastern part is the mountain range. It's fast metamorphic rocks. And the western and eastern coasts are the slower material sediments. And the slowest is this west coast, on the west coast. So this is the earthquake, the example that we have seen before. And after 2 minutes after the earthquake, we get this solution, focal magnitude solution. And then we can run this retrieval of the Green's function to get the shake movie.
We don't have much more time.
Okay. So you can see this is a small earthquake, about 3.2 magnitude, and you can see it's basically isotropic ground motion, and you can also get the shake map, the PTV map. So near the source, it looks like from a point source, and the outliers, they are the results of topography and 3D earth structure. And so we can also use a finite source. This is the comparison for a larger earthquake in southern Taiwan. And on the left, I'll show a point source ground shake movie, and on the right, it's from a finite source. So on the left, you can see it's a symmetrical circles going from the source. But on the right, from the finite source, you can see a clear directivity to the northwest. So this is for shake movies. And with the shake map, a very straightforward use for the shake. A very straightforward use for the shake map is to quickly identify the two play, to resolve the fault plane ambiguity. So on the left is the observed PTV map, and in the middle is the PTV map from this northwest striking fault plane, and on the right is the PTV map from the conjugate plane. And just by visually, you can by visual comparison, you can tell that this is this has a better agreement with the observed PTV map. But we can also see that on the west, we probably need to improve our site amplification. So this is the summary. Basically, we have a system to quickly get the ground motions, and we can use 3D earth structure and with topography side effect and finite sources. And finally, with the emerging technologies, we can speed this up even more, so we can get the results in a few minutes. Thank you for your attention.